Oh, dear God, thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord, you are God. I've updated that already. Your name is glorified. You are glorified in the heavens. You are glorified on earth. All authority in the heaven and the earth has been given to you. Receive all glory today. Thank you, Father, for your glory that's coming down. Thank you, Lord, for ability. Your spirit that's at work in us. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Glory to your name. Glory, glory, glory. Thank you for today. So it started now, right? Hey folks, thanks for joining Hajarat Princess Forumba. Thank you for joining, Prince. I got a prince, I got a princess, number one and number two. That means there's something royal about today. Thank you, Brother Emmanuel Isangbedo. Please share, let light go viral. Share, 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 share. So what's happening there now? We're coming 1 hour exactly behind schedule. What happened? Connected now. Okay, thank you, Father. Glory.
Hello.
Hello, y'all. Good morning. Odion Ibuga here on the hashtag Matthew 24:14 show live on Gospel Tainment Radio. I'm reaching you today from our studios, Gospel Tainment Studios at the Keja, Lagos. It's a very incredible 12th day of December 2018, and the Lord is glorified today. He is glorified that His Spirit runs on our inside, and is He that's at work in us, both to will and to do of His good pleasure. Now, we've come to realize that the singular pleasure of God is the revelation of Jesus Christ. So it's come to our knowing now that Jesus is being revealed in us, and it gives God pleasure for this to happen. And this is what the Holy Spirit actually does. You see, when our Master was sending us out, He told us in Acts chapter 1 verse 8. He said, "And you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you. And you shall be witnesses unto me." The capacity to be witnesses unto Jesus is what defines us as the church. The capacity to give the proof that Jesus is alive today. This is what defines us as the church. So the church becomes a community of faith. Located in territories of the earth, exclusively in the advance of the kingdom of God, exclusively in the advance of the government of Jesus, exclusively in the advance of the reign of Jesus, we are concerned about the things that concern the lordship of Jesus. We must bring the lordship of Jesus to our societies. We must bring the lordship of Jesus to our cities. And this is what this show is all about. Is the biggest prophetic expectation that heaven has planned for the earth. And if you look back at what Jesus said, I want to say it's the biggest prophetic expectation. Today, in Matthew chapter 24 verse 14, Jesus said, "And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness to every nation." It shall be preached in all the world. It shall be practiced and taught in all the world for a testimony to the nations. And then the end shall come. It's such an incredible privilege that we've been given by God to be among this generation of people across the nations of the world who will give this same testimony of Jesus, who will be the preachers of this gospel of the kingdom. It's such a good news for the nations of the world that the hold of self be broken over the shoulders of our leaders, the hold of corruption and sin and death be broken. Such a good news that the nations will be repaired, the devastations will be rebuilt, and the desolations of many generations will be raised up, because God is raising a generation of saviors in the nations of the world. He's raising a generation of deliverers, people who are going in the name of Jesus, empowered by the Spirit of God to bring fulfillment to Scripture. These people are led by the Holy Spirit. These people are preaching the gospel to the poor. These people, they are mending the broken hearts. These people, they are casting out devils. They are binding devils, and they are setting new experiences for people in their experience. These people are living a thirst and a taste for an encounter with God in the hearts of people of their experience. It's such an incredible expectation that we are having, and this is what we are living for. By the grace of God, we are come in the name of Jesus to advance the kingdom reign of Jesus in the world. It's an opportunity for the world to step into newness. It's an opportunity for the world to step into the best parts of God's providence. It's an opportunity for the world to come into a government, to come into an order of justice, an order of righteousness, an order of peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. And this is the plan that God has. And he revealed it to us as the mystery that he has hidden God even before the time began, even before the world was created. Such an incredible opportunity we have to be on this podium and promote this singular global agenda. It's concerning the reign of Jesus. It's concerning the 1,000-year-long earthly reign of Jesus. The reign of righteousness, reign of justice, reign of peace. I'm talking about having a time where death and diseases will not be a thing to be afraid about on earth. And I make bold to promote this gospel. I make bold to tell the nations of the world that it's time to come to the end of yourself. People of every nation, it's time to come to the end of yourself. It's time to come to the end of your abilities. It's time to come to the end of your mind. It's time to come to the end of your talent, the end of your gift, the end of what you feel is going for you that is outside Christ. The time has come to depend on the person of Christ. He is the only God-approved person that is allowed to operate and walk on earth. This is what he is doing. He's still out today, walking through the church. He is moving to establish his government on the earth. He is moving to seek and save the lost. He is moving to bring reconciliation of all things back to God. He is moving to establish the culture of heaven, the tradition of heaven, the lifestyle of heaven, the mindset of heaven. He is moving to establish the new norm. Righteousness as the new norm. Godliness as the new natural norm. What a pleasure, what a privilege this would be for the nations of the earth. And on that blast, on that ground, I want to say welcome to my listeners. It's so good to be on this part of the ministry experience. And I know that I'm reaching out to people all across the world. Our listeners all over the place. Listeners in America. Listeners in North America. I got a lot of listeners in Canada, a lot of these listeners in the Caribbean. I want to just say thank you and welcome again. I want to welcome you today from other parts of Africa. We're reaching out to people in Tanzania, as far as South Africa. We're reaching out to people in North Africa today. And I'm saying welcome to people in Europe. Welcome to my brothers and friends in the Arabia, in Asia, in Australia, in Greenland. Welcome. It's time for the preaching of the gospel of the kingdom. It's this one. It's not really the gospel of prosperity or the gospel of well-being or the gospel of excellence. It's not the gospel of service delivery. I'm preaching this gospel of the kingdom. It's the same gospel that Jesus the Christ preached during his earthly ministry. I'm telling you, through the power of the Holy Ghost that lives in the believer, this is the same gospel that Jesus preaches. Now, I didn't say Jesus preached anymore. I came with a new revelation. It's Jesus that is preaching the message through an agency that he calls his church. So we're bringing definition to the church, and we're pointing the people back to the Jesus who lives, who comes in the flesh. Jesus who comes and who at best is discernible. So I'm calling forth a generation of people to come to the end of themselves in your capacity to just see with your naked eyes the person of Jesus. You must discern the body. You must discern the presence of Jesus in the brethren. And you must engage the brethren with the perception. It's a perception. It's a discernment. You must realize that Jesus has come in again to the world through another door. That means your brother, you, if you believe, and this man that's talking to you has become an avenue for Jesus to come in. And this is an incredible expectation that God has, that the manifestation of Jesus will be achieved in the world. When the manifestation is achieved and people are discipled in this prophetic being, I'm talking about the Christ state of being, imagine what benefit this will pose to our world. We're going to come and recreate the world. We're going to come and reproduce a new culture, a new way of life. And this is what we are about. It's about this gospel of the kingdom. It's about the reign of Jesus. It's about the reign of righteousness. And this is what the church has been sent to project. This is what the church has been sent to propagate. This is what church has been sent to reveal and baptize the nations into. This is the Great Commission. We must return to the Great Commission, irrespective of how far and wide our religions have taken us through. We must come back to the basics. We must come back to the Great Commission. Our responsibility to make disciples of all the nations. Our responsibility to move into the territories of the earth and promote the authority of Christ. First over human beings, and then over territories. We must rid the devil of his right to influence territories on the earth, and we must produce as a foretaste for a 1,000-year-long reign of peace, justice, and fairness, righteousness on the earth for 1,000 years. We are going to give a foretaste to the nations of the world. We are going to give a foretaste of this life where the devil will not have authority over people and territories. The devil's work in the land, first of all in our lives, through the propagation of lust and pride and the locker and lust of the eyes and lust of the flesh, the pride of life will be tamed in our lifetime. I'm telling you today, that is not by power, neither is it by might, but it's by the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God in you gives you power to control yourself. The Spirit of God in you gives you power to endure hardship. The Spirit of God in you gives you power to love your enemies. The Spirit of God in you gives you power to operate beyond the capacity of the natural man. And this is who the church has become in Christ. We've been a people that have self-control. Glory. I want you to tell the Lord that you are ready to submit your body. Tell Jesus to come in, because this is what it is. When the word of reconciliation is being preached, so long as there is a believer, there is an impartation of life. I want you to have a seller moment on that. The impartation of life. And this is exactly what the Lord of the harvest wants. He wants his life installed in the hearts of an entire generation. This is his plan. This is his plan. Glory to God. Fred Hammond is coming with Lord of the Harvest. Let's be blessed as we listen. Glory.
We worship you. Turn our Lord. Age to age.
Hello, Benefi Solomon. Thank you, Pastor Mugbe. Thank you so much, Aloe Oshuku. Thank you so much for joining today. The hand of the Lord is upon you all. Please share to your contacts and let them know that this gospel of the kingdom is being preached, and they should join, because there's something that God is inspiring us now to teach. And I want you also to pray for me, so I will have divine utterance to deliver on this mandate. Glory to God.
You're Lord of the harvest. Turn our life, yeah, each to take your place, Lord, you rule. We come to worship you.
Yeah, that's a nice one from Fred Hammond, Lord of the Harvest. An incredible song. You see, he's not the Lord of the seed. So God is not asking a seed from you. He is the Lord of the Harvest. He has planted a seed and he has sent you on a mission. He needs a harvest. If God is coming to give you an encounter today, is on the ground that he expects a harvest. The offering that God needs today is not your money. What God needs today is your body, because he wants a harvest of his word in the world. Every word that has been spoken will not come back to him void. Jesus has started a new order, that the word that God has spoken will come back to God with your body. Hey, Kota Balada Sada. Jesus is effecting this because he started a new generation of people who shall, by the help of the Holy Spirit, find where it is written about them in scripture and bring the word of God to pass. And this is what I'm calling you into, and this is what I want you established on, that your eyes of your understanding may be enlightened, that your heart may be enlightened, that you might capture the word that God has spoken about you, so that you can bring the Lord a harvest. That's all I'm doing. I'm calling forth a generation who are concerned and have taken the responsibility to bring the Lord a harvest. Somebody put your hands together if you are part of that generation. I want you to lift up your right hand and say, thank you, Jesus. Glory, glory, glory. Speaking about this, our present help, this one who has sent us out to deliver a harvest for the nation, a harvest of the nations. I want you to celebrate this God. Celebrate him in his capacity to deliver on his counsel. This is all he has done. He has given us a privilege to partake in the ministry of reconciliation, and is on the ground that he wants all things to be under his authority. He wants the world. He wants to lead the nations of the world. He wants to lead the people of every nation. He doesn't want the people of every nation to look for nationhood out of his presence. He wants his presence and his power and his authority to determine the policy of nations. He wants to establish his commandments as the only law that is acceptable in every territory of the earth. Jesus wants to rule and reign on earth. Now, it's not just a rule where he will lord himself over you. No, Jesus wants to share himself so that every single citizen will have a commonwealth. And the commonwealth is actually their right to manifest Jesus. It's a world that is filled with Jesus that God has sent us out to produce. We are sent here to reconcile the world and fill the world with Jesus through the power of the Holy Ghost. And this is the great commission that the Lord is sending us back to go and establish our understanding on. This is what he has planned to do on the earth. At this time, he has planned to raise a generation of people across the nations that will place their uttermost priority on delivering on the counsel of God. This is the counsel of God. It's called the Great Commission. Matthew chapter 28, verse 18 to 19. No, let me even go back to 16. And then the 11 disciples went away into Galilee to the mountain which Jesus had appointed for them. That means Jesus appointed for them a place of influence. The mountain speaks about a geographical feature of influence. It denotes influence over society. So there is a mountain. I want you to open your prophetic eyes now and begin to sense that there is something about the mountain of the Lord's house. And it's the mountain of the Lord's house that Jesus had appointed for them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him. But some doubted. I'm talking about a people who have only one thing to do on top of the mountains of influence. We must raise an influence for the people of the earth that will give God worship. We must raise a mountain of worship where every influence that society goes under will give God glory. And that's what we are about, especially at a time when the world is perturbed by death and crime, especially at a time when the family system of the world is going from depth of decadence to another, especially when the morality question, the morality narrative has become so decadent, especially when corruption has riddled the nations and bedeviled the nations, especially when so much ignorance is being proliferated in our education, especially when fear has become the order of the day, it is important for us to realize that Jesus has sent us and appointed a place of authority, the mountain of the Lord's house. He has appointed us the place where we have the right to reveal him in his authority. He has appointed the place for us, and we must be found there worshiping. The worshiper means self is not as much expressed as you see today. The worshiper is void of self. The glory is given to God. We must be the generation of people who are operating from the mountain, from the place of influence that Jesus has appointed for us. And we must be doing only one thing there. We must be worshiping. We must realize that the hand of God is upon us, and we have one responsibility to do on the place of influence, which is to render the Lord worship. Do I have worshipers in the building? If you are a worshiper, it means you are ready to go on the agenda of God. If you are a worshiper, it means you are zealous about taking the territories of the earth and souls for the kingdom. If you are a worshiper, it means you have neglected yourself in the scheme of things. You have thrown away everything that will be beneficial for your flesh. You have tamed your flesh and mortified your members such that the Lord be glorified through your body. And now Jesus came and he spoke to them saying, it was not just a mere word, it was a command. He said, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. That's an incredible place to be. All authority has been given to me. And this is the resurrected Jesus that sent us out. And this is the person that we must return to. This is the person that we must go back and tell how we did, whatever we did in our bodies, whatever we did in the advance of this agenda. What did he tell us to do? He said, go therefore on the ground that all authority in the heavens and the earth has been given to me. Go on that ground and make disciples of all the nations. Now I'm telling you that the church of Jesus Christ, much like a fisherman, is sent with a hook. The church is sent with a net, and the church is sent with a dragnet. Yes, especially to pull nations ashore into righteousness. We must pull the nations from the place where they are dwindling in their confusion, and we must pull them into righteousness. We must make disciples of all nations. We came with an anointing that can affect the cultural exchange. We have come to change the narrative in the cultural experience of nations. And this is what the church is about. We have come to establish new standards for influence. We have come to establish a discipling culture in the nations of the world. We have come to tell them how they should run their lives. We have come to tell them how they should run their businesses. We have come to tell them how they should run their laws. We have come to redefine the experience of nations. And this is why the church, the best gift that heaven has given to any society, exists today. People are sent into the world with the singular responsibility to make disciples of every nation. We must pattern the nations after the culture of Jesus. We must pattern the nation after the discipline of Christ. We must pattern the nation in the government of Christ. We must pattern the nation after the education of Christ. We must pattern the nation after the fashion of Christ or the tradition of Christ. We must pattern the nation after the morality of Christ. This is what the church is sent to the world to do. And this is what the Christian church has subtly despised. So there is need for us to return to the basics. And permit me to prophesy that the Lord is sending a new generation of leaders that will point the church back to the basics. Her responsibility to make disciples of all the nations. He didn't say some of the nations. He said all the nations. We're talking about discipleship here, and we're seeing a perfect example of discipleship in the nation political structures. We see Nigeria today, we're a disciple of America. We're patterned our lives after the order of the American culture. And this disciple-master relationship is expressed in every of our elements of culture. It is expressed in the way we tell our news. It is expressed in the way we dress. It is expressed in the way we talk. In our education, is expressed essentially in our government. It is expressed in our religions, especially in Christianity. Is the American prosperity model that we patterned our lives after. It's expressed in the way we get entertained. Look at the American signature in our entertainment. Yes, it is also expressed in our preference now, which is new but is coming in with breakneck speed, our preference for the proliferation of the LGBTQ thought. I'm talking about America's capacity to disciple Nigeria and many other nations of the world. Politically, we're in another election season. We have come into another electioneering campaign season. And you see the model which we have now been practicing religiously, because every 4 years we repeat the process and we start a new system. It is in the pattern of American democracy. We have embraced a new worldview. And this is exactly what Jesus Christ has sent the church into the world to do. We are supposed to establish nations in new world views, different from what they have taken up for themselves. We are supposed to bring a heavenly worldview, the worldview of the kingdom of God, where righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost will become a norm. And this is what we have been sent to do. I don't know, somehow the devil, through the proliferation of the Christian thought and Christianity, has locked us up in our churches, and we have looked away from our capacity to deliver on this agenda. We are sent into the world to make disciples of all the nations, not some of the nations. We are supposed to make disciples of all the nations and pattern the nations in the discipline of Christ, especially as it is what the world requires now. If you go around the world, you see much decadence and fear and corruption and evil and wars and strife and division. But it is not supposed to be so. In the beginning, it was not so. The church is sent, and we have a creed for this revolution that we are embarking on. And we are saying, in the beginning, it was not so. We're turning the world back to a new narrative. We're turning the world back to a new cultural disposition. We're turning the world back to a new lifestyle. It's a new worldview, and we're bringing it. As much as the Holy Spirit is helping us, we're communicating these patterns to the nations of the world. It's a new pattern for government. It's a new pattern for our education. It's a new pattern for our welfare. It's a new pattern for our morality. It's a new pattern for our families. We're taking the world back to the way it was in the beginning, where everybody is in the position called righteousness, and they are doing the will of God. Make disciples of every nation, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Such an incredible thing. Baptism means baptizo. It means to immerse. And we must first look at the original pattern for baptism in the Jewish tradition. Now, we have seen baptism as a way to identify with the death of Christ. And everyone who is baptized is raised up in Christ into a new world. So there's a pattern to this baptizing that Jesus Christ sent the church to do to the nations. We must baptize people and bring them, raise them up into the newness of life that Jesus Christ has called the world and called man to walk in Him. This is a goal, and it's not what we can do in our Christian churches. I want us to, at this point, not even look at it that it has to do with baptizing an entire nation. 180 million people, baptize all of them. No, that's not the goal. The goal is actually to immerse the nations in the transdispensational agenda of God. We must take the nations back to the times when God was for man. You know, you see, pray in the Holy Ghost for a while. Please pray in the Holy Ghost so that you understand what I'm saying. There's something I am saying. This gospel of the kingdom, the political thought, is God's government plan for man through the salvation of man. God's redemption plan is actually the government in Christ that God has given the world. He gave the world a government. For unto us a child is born, for unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. Is a government that will establish the world in justice and righteousness again. Is a government that will lead the world in the path of righteousness. Is a government that will connect the world back to heaven. Because the world was already lost in sin by the fall of Adam, Jesus actually brought a redemption to man that will connect the world and all the influences that the world goes under back to heaven. And this is what the church has been sent to do. We are supposed to connect the world back to the Father. That's the ministry of reconciliation that we have been given in Christ. We have been given this word of reconciliation so that the world will not be destroyed, so that the world will not enter into an oblivion. But if you look carefully, the world is going in breakneck speed because the principalities and the powers have established a status quo in the world that has allowed self and sin to lead the degenerate man. And much of what man has been doing, especially with the propagation of the political philosophies of the world, is moving in the whims and the caprices of his self. And self has only one place to lead man to: decadence, corruption, ultimately death and hell. But we've come on an intervention move, and it started when God sent us on this agenda. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations. Proclaim the kingdom of God and tell them that the biggest opportunity to connect back to heaven has come. And tell them that God's government for man, with man, and in man is the same yesterday, today, and forever. God has plans and programs to communicate with the peoples of the world that will guide their everyday life. Such an incredible plan that we must come back to. God wants to guide your life. God wants to lead you. God wants to lead you. And this is what He has sent us to proclaim. He wants to lead the world. He wants to establish new policies. He wants to establish new systems and institutions that will govern your life. And you must repent and return to God. You must repent and return to God. This is the agenda. We must get the nations to find their identity in the transdispensational agenda of God. When He was running as the Father with the children of Israel, He led them in the wilderness and He baptized them in the wilderness. They came through the Red Sea. That was the baptism, because Egypt became a thing of the old, and they were walking into new ground, so their promised land. They were baptized every day when they walked across the pillar of cloud by day and the pillar of fire by night. That was God's plan to lead His people. He communicated that plan to the people in the children of Israel in the wilderness. While He was working out this historical masterpiece, He secured a life insurance plan for the people, where much of them who smelled the blood of the Lamb on their doorpost were saved when the angel of death came into the nation to wreak havoc. There was a welfare plan. Much of them, all of them, were in the wilderness and they depended on manna and quail every day of their life. That's a plan that a government will have to secure the welfare of the people of the nation. That plan ran that time. That plan ran in the time of Jesus. And now, if you believe, that plan will run and it will affect the manifestation of a generation who will rise to the occasion, especially when food shortage has become a problem for the nations of the world. There is a welfare plan in the government of Jesus Christ. Nations, we must get you to believe, and we must get you to find your identity in this agenda. The nations of the world must find their identity in the agenda of God, so that they will find succor from the prevalent decadence of the contemporary societies in the world. There was a health plan right in the wilderness. And we found out that those of them that were bitten by snakes, so long as they kept their focus on the brazen serpent, the Bible says they were healed. There was a plan to send out the demons ahead of them. I'm telling you how God sent away the people who were inhabiting the promised land right before them. He communicated that plan to the children of Israel, led them out of slavery, and He led them into a land of promise. We can find that this leadership scenario continued unto the day of Jesus. And Jesus Christ said in Matthew chapter 4, verse 17, He began to preach and to say, "Follow me." No. That's not what He was saying there. He began to preach and to say, "Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. The kingdom of heaven is at hand." If we go right down that scripture, we will find where verse 18 and 19, where He walked and decided to recruit His disciples. He said something. He said, "Follow me, I will make you fishers of men." This is the objective of what we are doing today, but I want to look at the Great Commission first of all before we come into fishing, because something very prophetic about fishing that the Lord is pointing us back to. But before we go then, let's first be established on the Great Commission. We have to baptize the nations, fully immerse the nations, much like a laundryman in Africa. Most of what we do to our dirty laundry, we take this dirty piece of clothing and we soak the clothes in a bucket that is filled with water, the lathery water, soapy water. It's so much that the clothes, we really do not see the clothes anymore until we go into the bucket to wash it. We have to go into the bucket, retrieve the clothes right in the water. Now, this is what God wants the church to do to the nations of the world. We must completely soak the nations of the world in this transdispensational agenda so that the people will be able to see how Jesus can bring solutions to their problem as a king. Jesus is worthy to be believed and obeyed because he is God's government. He is God's king that has a plan and a vision for how the nations will be. And this is what the church has been sent to promote in every territory of the world. We are sent into the world to promote the agenda of God's government. I'm talking about the government of Jesus Christ. And all we need to do is to allow the nations of the world, leaders of every nation, all the people of authority, they must submit to this plan so that they can have the much needed succor and peace and national development that have eluded them hitherto. We must cause the nations to be immersed in God's transdispensational agenda so that they can find their identity in God's agenda. You don't see Nigeria no more. You have to go into the agenda of God to say, okay, Nigeria, what is your place in God's agenda? Nigeria, what's your expectation in God's agenda? How should you define your policy statements? How should you define yourself? How should you run your government? It must be in the agenda of God. Until we embrace this message, we will be doomed with corruption. Because man is a fundamental problem that man is facing today, is the power of self over the souls of men. And so long as self has his authority, much of them will come with promises that they will change your lot, that they will secure power, that they will secure good roads. They will come with their outlandish plans, and when they get there, they will do all they have always known to do, which is to follow after the whims and caprices and the proclivities of their natural self. It is only Jesus that can put an end to the reign of self in the heart of men. And this is why we are proclaiming the kingdom of God. We are shouting it today as we have life in our bodies, as we have air in our lungs. We are proclaiming that it's time, enough is enough. We must put the reign of self to an end so that we'll give the Lord the harvest. We must secure and enthrone Jesus today through the power of the Holy Spirit. We'll be able to come against the power of self over the souls of men. And men will be free to experience the booty and the plenty that heaven has for the nations of the world. Yes, the gospel is for everyone. The gospel is for every nation. The gospel is for every tribe. The gospel is for every tongue. The gospel is for every ethnicity. We must not make it a Christian thing. It's not about Christianity here. It's about securing the government of Jesus Christ in the nations of the world so that peace, serenity, justice, and righteousness will be established as the norm on the earth. Until the nations are baptized in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, they will not position themselves for the ministry of sons of God. They will not position themselves for the ministry of deliverers. They will not position themselves for the ministry of saviors. It is God's plan for saviors to rise up upon Mount Zion and judge the mountains of Edom. It is God's plan for the nations to be repaired. It is God's plan for the desolations of the many generations to be raised up. It is God's plan for the old waste places to be repaired, to be rebuilt. But the nations must be baptized in this agenda so that they will find their identity in this agenda, so that they will submit their lands and submit their bodies and submit their people, submit their resources, submit their talents, submit their cultures, submit everything so that Jesus can do his work of nation building. The biggest nation builder in the world today, his name is Jesus. And he has given the church the capacity to witness to him. not just witnessing to him to raise a generation of Jesus and fill the whole earth with this generation of Jesus. This is the gospel. It's my gospel. It is God's power unto salvation to everyone who believes. We must teach them to observe all the things that Jesus has commanded us. What are the commandments of Jesus? We must teach the nations to observe them. My beloved sister-in-law just joined, and I'm going to say welcome, because what I'm going to say is just timely for you. There is one incredible commandment that Jesus Christ has given to us. We must make an institution out of each and every commandment that Jesus has given. One of them, he told us that we must not swear. Are you with me? Are you with me? Our King told us, thou shall not swear. Hold on for a minute. Stay with me, meditate on it. I have lawyers in the building. Jesus has commanded us that we must not swear. Let our yes be yes, and let our nay be nay. Oh, glory to God. Listen to me. The agenda that God has sent the nation, the church out into the nations to do is to pattern the nations after his discipline, pattern the nations after his government, immerse the nations in his trans-dispensational agenda so that the nations will find their identity in God, and we must teach them to observe. You must teach them to observe. Teach them to align themselves. Matthew chapter 5, verse 34. Everything is changed. We are bringing this change to every society in our nations. We are bringing this change. We are bringing it. We are bringing it. We are bringing it. In the name of Jesus, the nations will believe this message. They will believe and they will line up with this message. As long as the Lord lives. Listen to me. Verse 33, again, you have heard that it said to the people long ago, do not break your oaths, but keep the oaths you have made to the Lord. The making of oaths, is this part of our culture, our legal culture today? In every nation, the breaking and the making of oaths, swearing, is it part of our culture today? Now, this is Jesus, letters written in red. Jesus says, but I tell you, not to swear at all. It's a commandment that Jesus Christ has given to us. His letters written in red. And if Jesus is our Lord, like we proclaim, this must be our practice. By the grace of God, through the power of the Holy Spirit, we'll be able to produce societies that are Christ compliant, especially on the ground that they don't swear. I tell you, do not swear at all, either by heaven, for it is God's throne, or by the earth, for it is his footstool, or by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. And do not swear by your head, for you cannot even make one hair white or black. This message is not to only blacks. It's talking to Americans. It's talking to people of every tribe, the old, the young. You can't make a hair, whether it's white man's hair or black man's hair. You can't make it, so do not swear by your hair. Simply let your yes be yes and your no, no. Anything beyond this comes from the evil one. This is exactly what Jesus Christ said here. Let your yes be yes. Let your nay be nay. Why? Because the spirit of truth lives on your inside. The spirit of truth, the anointing of the Lord which you have received of Christ, lives on your inside. So your yes has got to be your yes. Your no has got to be your no. We must raise a people of integrity, a people who keep their words, a people who make righteous judgments must rise on the earth. A generation of sons must rise that will make this command an instituted command in the nations of the earth. Jesus Christ says, anything beyond this comes from the evil one. So what are the things beyond this? we'll go and do legal marriage, right? We'll go marry in the court of law, and we hold a Bible, or at every practice in the court, we carry our Bible, and we say, we make a swear that everything I say is the truth and nothing but the truth, so help me God. Hello, which God? That's the evil one that you have called God. And this is the legal foundation that supports the government of the Antichrist that we have come to embrace today. All of us have embraced it, yet we profess the Lordship of Jesus, but we have embraced a style of life that is especially from the evil one. Now we have swearing in ceremony. Every political leader, after he has won his election, he carries a Bible and he swears that he must serve the people rightly. Even if he's going there to do corrupt things, he's there lying. He has started deceiving himself. He has started going against the commandment of Jesus. So this is what the church must be sent to stop. If the church is alive in any given society, the church must bring a new narrative for government and the way law is being communicated and dispensed. The church must bring a new narrative. The church must bring a new culture. The church must effect a cultural exchange in the society. Anything that doesn't do this is of the evil one. And this is why we are preaching today. This gospel of the kingdom is Christ's right to bring the nations of the world under his commandment. Christ's right to bring the nations of the world under his authority. Christ's right to establish Christ's controlled territories on the earth. And it will happen in our lifetime. The Lord is glorified. And this is the ultimate harvest that God will have on the nations of the earth. That Christ's compliant territories will be found on the earth. That we will really see that everything is changed. We will really see that it's not as it was before. People have embraced a new way of life. People have embraced and they have been baptized into the death of Jesus. And they have been raised up into a new lease to life. So that means they are expecting the next command that Jesus is giving. Hey! They are expecting the next command that Jesus is giving. They are expecting to go under the love of Christ. The Matthew 5 specifically talks about the commands that we must establish. Matthew 5 is a book that the church must use to establish the government of Jesus Christ in the territories of the earth. It's a new constitution that he has given us. And we must pattern the lives of people by way of principle, by way of legislation, after the commandments of this book. That means you and I, people of every tribe, tongue, ethnicity, and nation, they must find their part in this book. And it's only then we can give the Lord of the harvest his harvest. Hello? There are people in the building. There are people in the building. The Lord has promised change. And he said he will do a quick one. Stay with me. This is JJ Heston and Youthful Praise. Everything is changed.
And full healings in my life.
Oh my God.
Everything is restored.
Everything
I lost is now restored. All of my past is gone.
All of my past is gone.
All the hurt and all the pain is gone.
All of the pain is gone. Everything has changed
for me.
For me.
I believe it today. Come on, say that again. I believe
that your heart is changed. I believe
his word.
And I receive.
Look, I see I have one last.
His word.
Yes. Glory. That's a beautiful song. JJ Heston and Youthful Praise. Everything is changed. Now, everything is changed when the gospel is preached. Everything is changed when Christ is involved. Everything is changed when believers have risen up in the nations of the world. Everything is changed when the church has been given such prophetic expression. Everything is changed when a generation of deliverers has risen up in the nations of the world to communicate the gospel of the kingdom to the peoples of every tribe, tongue, nation, ethnicity, language, and creed. Everything is changed when a new culture is promoted in the nations of the world. Everything is changed when the spiritual transactions to rid the lands of the influence of demons has been effected by the church who understand the fellowship of these mysteries, who understand how to deploy the manifold wisdom of God. We must rid the nations of his death grip over the souls of the people of every nation. We must establish new moral conditionings. We must establish a new cultural conditionings. And this is what the agenda that Jesus has sent the church to deliver on. He said we must go into the world and preach the gospel to every creature. We must go into the world and preach the gospel to every creature. We must tell them that the time has come to the end of themselves. We must tell them to embrace the help that comes from the realms of the Spirit. We must tell them that not by power, not by might, but by my Spirit, says our King. We must tell them that Jesus is God. He has a government and he has plans to establish every nation in his culture, to establish every nation in his government, to establish every nation in his policy statement, to establish every nation. We are ambassadors for Christ. We are moving within the territories of foreign nations and we are promoting the agenda of our King. This is why we are alive as the Church of Christ in every nation. Now, what am I saying? I am saying that the church is defined not as an organization that runs business, is registered by Corporate Affairs Commission, and is tolerated by the state. I'm talking about the church, this community of faith that's made up of one family, one Church of Jesus Christ, established in different territories of the earth. I prophesy the birthing of the Church of Christ in Lagos. I prophesy the birthing of the Church of Christ in Nigeria. I prophesy the birthing of the Church of Christ in Holland. Elvis, you are in the building. I prophesy the birthing of the Church of Christ in England. I call for the Church of Christ in Canada. I call for the Church of Christ in London. I call for the Church of Christ in Arabia, in Saudi Arabia. I call for the Church of Christ. People who realize that God has given them three things to fish for men. Stay with me. Stay with me. One of the biggest revelations that I got last week was the opening of the book of Habakkuk. Stay with me. There's something heavy now. This is the core of what I'm going to do today. And I receive grace to deliver just the way I'm hearing in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father, for mercy. Thank you, Lord, for ability. I deliver today as you have said it concerning this particular issue. Lord, have your way. Let your will be done in the name of Jesus. Now, if you go back to Matthew chapter 4, you are going to see in verse 17 and 18 and 19, Jesus giving a call to his disciples. He says, come, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. Now, I want us to embrace this scripture with a renewed conditioning, because much of what Christianity has adopted in this particular subject, we have grossly misconstrued the concept of fishing for men, and we ourselves have become fishes in the nets of the wicked men. Now, when Jesus says he will make us fishers of men, it means he equips us as fishermen. We are supposed to throw our hook. We are supposed to throw our net. We are supposed to throw our dragnet into the many waters of the world. And we are supposed to pull ashore. That's discipleship now. Because there's a followership there. The fish caught our hook. And we started shoving the fish on the path of righteousness. That means there is a prophetic expression of the church as fishers of men. We are supposed to shove the nations. We are using the hook for individuals. You must be able to understand the dynamics of fishing with a hook. I believe this is what the perfecting of the saints must entail. Now the church begins to learn the techniques of fishing, and they begin to learn best ways to engage their hook. Now, can you imagine a church without the knowledge of her hook? A church without the knowledge of her net? A church without the knowledge of her dragnet? That's a calamity that's already happening, because fishes will be doing all they want to do, and the church will even see responsibility to even engage the fish and bring something home for our God. Listen to me carefully. God has equipped the church with three things: the hook, the net, and the dragnet. The church that doesn't wake up to the knowledge of the deployment or the wisdom that is required to fish with these three things will itself become fishes in the hook, the net, or the dragnet of the wicked one. This is where the Christian church is today, because we lost sight of our hook, we lost sight and the knowledge of our net, we lost the unity that is required to engage the in gathering of fish. We have become a bundle of people in the net of the wicked. Many of us don't want to believe it, but it's true. Any government of the state that doesn't like the church will shut down the church. And it's already seen, they have shown us proof already, that we have become as a fish or sea creatures without rulers. And we are just doing our thing, divided in our own way, running our life without knowledge of these three things. Now, this is a call that Jesus Christ gave for the third world nations and the first world nations. We've gone beyond this already. Go to our past recording. I began to show the call of Jesus to nations, two categories of nations, the first world nations and the third world nations. The first world nations in Peter and Andrew, and the third world nations in James and John. The first world nations, they were casting their nets. The third world nations, they were sitting in the boat with their father, they were mending their nets. Listen to me. The third world nations today, Nigeria, is sitting in the boat with our father, the Zebedees of this world, England and America, and we are mending democracy. Our net is democracy. Our net is Christianity. We are mending the net. The net has not united us as a nation, but we are mending the net. The net has not delivered good future for our children, but we are mending our net. The net has not operated in its optimal capacity, but we are mending our net. The right to mend the net is not yours to take. So you must follow after the government of Jesus, because Jesus, you must follow after King Jesus, because Jesus has a government that will give you work to reel fish for men. We are supposed to cast our nets into many waters. And sometimes we may need to be united. That means there is more than one expression of unity, more than one expression of fishing. It could be that the Church of Christ in Lagos will work with the Church of Christ in Ondo to drag the entire Southwest into the shores of righteousness. These are dimensions that God will take us through on this revelation. The net, the hook, and the dragnet. Please listen to me carefully, because what God is doing now is giving definition to the church. When the Christian church are fighting and everybody is thinking about who wants to build a bigger building, and who is right or who is wrong, or who is collecting tithe or not, God is raising his church. In the end time, in the time of harvest, you are going to see the wheat or the tares, either of them standing separate, and they are distinguishable. The wheat are moving in the advance of the kingdom of God. The tares are doing big things and they are giving themselves glory. They are standing tall. The wheat are bowing, doing the work of God. There's expression of self in the tares. The wheat are doing the work of God. You should listen to me carefully. There's some light here. Now, when I'm studying this week, I found this book, Habakkuk chapter 1. I saw something very profound. And I saw that Prophet Habakkuk was actually raised for his time. He was raised with a burden for nations, especially on the ground that these nations were God's people, but they were under the reign of wickedness. Habakkuk, having the burden for the nation, he began to question God especially on the ground of God's judgment, how the nations are managed, how Israel and the nations that God loves are managed. Now, reasonable men, especially those that are the church, they must have a burden for the nation, because the church is the light of the world. The church without a burden for the nation, especially the pains and the misery of the people, the masses, is not the church of Christ. It's the evil one that established that church. So I'm calling forth the rise of a generation of people that have burden for society, especially when the power outages have become a concern, especially when health facilities and health service delivery is not deliverable in the nations. The church must have a burden for these things. And there was a prophet Haggai questioning the judgment of God. He said, how long shall I cry? Oh Lord, how long shall I cry? This is someone that has been crying and it seems like the Lord has not heard. He was not crying for his breakthrough. He was not crying for sickness in his body. He was not crying to be free from poverty. No, he was crying for the destiny of the land. I cry to you that violence has taken over the land and you will not save. I cry to you that iniquity and profanity has taken up and you are causing me to see all these things and plundering. Fulani headsmen here, Boko Haram there, there's plundering and destruction of the land. There is strife and contention all over the place, and the law has become powerless because the politicians are going against the law. Justice never goes forth. The wicked now surrounds the righteous. And the perversion of justice is what is always happening. This was the concern that Prophet Habakkuk has. It's the concern that every right-thinking church member, body of Christ, must have. Because we have a burden for the way the nations is. In the beginning, it was not so. This is the creed for the kingdom revolution. In the beginning, men were not marrying men. In the beginning, it was not so. In the beginning, it was not normal for lies to be world famous. Lies and liars are now world famous, and now the ones that are establishing the culture and the conditioning for the next generation. People now end their marriages on social media. As sanctified and hallowed as the institution of marriage is, people now end it on social media, and you think everything is all right. There must be a way out from this predicament, if not for yourself, for the next generation. This is the burden that we must have for the nations of the world, that the wicked now surrounds the righteous and the perverse judgment at every turn. There's perversion of judgment on every turn. Now, God is saying something here. He said, look amongst the nations and watch. I'm calling forth a generation of people who will watch. Be utterly astounded, for I will walk a walk in your days which you would not believe though it were told you. This is what God is saying. There's a quick walk that God is doing. There's a quick walk that God is doing, and this is what he's doing through us who are preaching this message. But I will take you to where is relevant in our conversation. It was when Prophet Habakkuk began his second section of querying before God. Are you not from everlasting, O Lord my God, my Holy One? We shall not die. Lord, you have appointed them for judgment. O rock, you have marked them for correction. He's talking about the wicked. You have poorer eyes than to behold evil. You have purer eyes than to behold evil and cannot look on wickedness. This should be our supplication to God. Why do you look on those who deal treacherously and hold your tongue when the wicked devours a person more righteous than he? Why do you make men like fish of the sea, like creeping things that have no ruler over them? Do you see the message that Jesus Christ sent the church, fishers of men? Now Habakkuk is saying, when the evil men, the wicked, are ruling over the territories of the earth, men have now become like fish of the sea at the mercy of the fisherman. Stay with me here. Like creeping things that have no ruler. Now, these men, many of them are Christians today, We have now become like fishes of the sea because some wicked fisherman has cast his net. This net is what we are trying to mend. Tight. The third world nations are trying to mend this net. Democracy and Christianity. The wicked men have cast the net. And God's own people have now become like fishes of the sea. We have been baited with it that we don't even know that it's right to drop it. We are going after it and the thing is leading us on a path of corruption. It's leading us on a path of selfishness. It's leading us on a path of greed and avarice. But we are still on it. We are hooked and stuck on it as though we don't have a leader. Listen to the punchline here. He said, they take all of them with a hook individually. They catch them in their net nationally. And they gather them in their drag nets. That is on the United Nations ground. On the grounds of the United Nations. You see? Zota paladasazis. We must understand what I'm saying. That the wicked still uses his hook, his net, and his drag net. Is actually these three that the church has failed to use. The wicked is now using it against the church and man. And they rejoice and are glad. There's big rejoicing and there's gladness in the camp of the wicked when nations are bought after, they are bought after this demonic political idea. What are they doing? They sacrifice to their nets and they burn incense to their drag nets. They sacrifice to their nets. Their democratic culture is ongoing. They are sacrificing to their nets. They are burning incense to their drag nets. Because by them, by their nets and their drag nets and their hooks, their share is sumptuous and their food plentiful. Their share is sumptuous because of the prevalence of their culture, the prevalence of their political philosophy. They have made themselves rich. They have assessed our resources. They have assessed our talent. They have assessed our brain. They have assessed the hidden riches in our earth. Now, their share is some sort of natural gas or crude oil. They have positioned us. But listen, this must come to an end. The reign of the wicked in the land must come to an end. We must not always also forget. We must not also forget that most of these people using their nets, their drag nets and hooks, sacrificing to it, is in the form of these political killings that we are seeing in our nations. There's a lot of sacrificing done to their nets and their drag nets to consolidate their grip on our territory. That's why you see much of the killings politically, as political related killings. That's why you see the increased tendency for human rituals happening in our nations today. Is supposed to consolidate the hold of the wicked on the land. But there is a prayer. It says, shall they therefore empty their net? Shall they continue to slay nations without pity? There is a help on the way. And this is why we're preaching this gospel of the kingdom. This is why we have to call the church back to her numero uno objective. We must be established on the Great Commission. We must go back to the knowing and the understanding of how our hook, our net, and our drag net works. We must be able to twist conversations when we are engaging people in our everyday life and twist the conversation into the things concerning the reign of Jesus. We must be able to give people a chance to believe our report. We must be able to have the skill, conversationary skills, to win and gain the attention of people so long as it is to the advance of the government of Jesus. We must be able to go into territories and proclaim the kingdom of God to nations. Paul was one who understood his net. He went straight to Festus Agrippa. At a point, Festus asked him, are you telling me that I should be a Christian like you? Are you trying to tell me to become a Christian? This was the goal in the heart of the early church, where people who understood their hook, their nets and their dragnet. The dragnet, when Peter caught a great catch, he called people to join him to shove the nets in. There's a level of unity of the faith that we must attain for us to be able to get nations and get them to submit to the agenda of Jesus. It's not just one man running and trying to struggle everything on by himself and get the harvest by himself. We need ourselves to bring in this harvest. And this revelation will open a new vista, and it will help us engage this harvest that is white, this sea, this water that is rich with fish, for our king, for our government, for our father. We must give the Lord a harvest, and it will define how we will be rewarded. The harvest we give to God, our position on his agenda, will define how we will be rewarded. And we must come into this knowing. We must come into this revelation. We must come into this believing that we are being sent on a mission in this world, not to run after ourselves. We are sent to come into the hope that God has for the nations, especially to the end that the nations will once again come under the reign of Jesus Christ. My name is Odione Puga. We had a very incredible time today on the hashtag Matthew 24:14 show. It was live on Gospel Tainment Radio. I want to say thank you everybody who joined today. It was a good time in the presence of God, and I want you to come back here again, study, and let's look again at where we have been, because much of what God is going to do now, he is going to communicate to us the best ways to come into his agenda. There is an agenda that God has for the nations of the world, and he is looking forward to seeing his church become relevant, in that the church is now operating from the place of authority and influence, moving in the territories of their being or their dwelling in the advance of the kingdom reign of Jesus Christ. Thank you all for watching. Till I see you again, please keep a date with us next week at the same time.
To the Pharisees,
bye now.
They were looking for a sign, and he called them the faithless and perverse generation.
Thank you, folks, for joining today. My battery is running down.
I don't do the work.
So I took a different position, but that's okay. Thank you very much for joining us today. Temi Tope Johnson, thank you. Joanne Omoyine, thank you so much, my sister. Elvis, thanks for joining. Thank you. Clement Benjamin, Ayo Joseph Michael, thank you for joining. Charles Azubike, thank you. Efrion Gabriel Richard Igogo, thank you very much. Kelly Priska, Rajik Saka, thank you for joining. I may not be able to name everybody, but like I always do, I want us to consider these folks, Gospel Tainment Radio. They've been far too kind to us, giving us their platform to use in the advance of this message. I want, you see, as much as God is talking to you to help us reach you, please reach out to us. Do an inbox to me, and you can communicate your help in cash, your kind, or even prayer, so that we'll be able to reach out. We'll be able to be sustained on this walk, and the Lord be glorified. For all who joined today, I want to say thank you again. Till I reach you again, it's going to be really do not know how often the Lord will inspire me to do this, but I trust that his name is glorified in all. Thanks for joining, and please share. Let this light reach the ends of the earth. God bless you.